Good morning, everyone. Myself Biren Shah. I belong to Engagement Service Group. Today's topic of whiteboard presentation is SWIFT Global Payments Innovation. So I'll start with what are we going to cover today. Okay. So we'll start with what is the current form of payment. Okay. How the exact currently the international payments are flowing through the different flows. Then we'll see what is the problem statement with respect to that. What are the challenges when we start or initiate the payment from one end of the continent to the other end. What is the GPI technology? The SWIFT has come up with the global payments innovation, that is the GPI technology. And post implementing GPI, how the things will differ and how those challenges are getting addressed. Then we will talk about each component of GPI, because GPI comes with a bundle of the packages. Okay, so we will talk in depth about each of them. Then we will talk about the pain points addressed. After addressing these pain points, what benefits you achieve as a corporate or as a bank. So as an individual, what all benefits or the objectives which are getting achieved, we will talk about that. Finally, the adoption of the impacted areas. So to adopt this SWIFTNet GPI, what all changes that we need to do in the environment or the infrastructure as a bank, what all impacted message types are, what all different APIs or the connectors that we need to configure as a part of GPI initiative, and the roadmap, finally the roadmap item. Okay, so SWIFT GPI is divided into three different phases. We are going to cover only about the phase one, which is currently live in the market and which is already released by the SWIFT. The phase two and the phase three part is going to upcoming. So these are the roadmap items which is yet in the development phase, and SWIFT is trying out with the pilot things with different banks or the financial institutions. Finally, we will summarize the things. So this is what we are going to talk about. So I'll start with the current form of the payment, how it exactly works right now in the payment domain. So consider a buyer who is residing in the South Africa, and there is a seller who is there in the USA or the United States of America. So now the buyer basically requests that I need some sort of goods in some sort of form, and this is the quantity and this is the quality of it. Seller accordingly ships the good, okay, along with the invoices. Once buyer receives the good, he has the invoice, he tries to match and compares, everything goes in line with it. After that, buyer tries to release the payment for the subsequent goods received. In that case, there is a buyer bank, which is a bank A or the ordering customer bank. There is a seller bank or the beneficiary bank, which is bank C, and there is an intermediary bank. Intermediary bank only comes when there is no direct relationship between the buyer and the seller's bank. Okay, hence the intermediary bank. There can be more than one intermediary bank in case there is no direct relationship between the correspondent bank or intermediary bank and beneficiary banks. Okay, so this hops will be increased accordingly. Now in this form of payment processing, the payment starts with here, it moves accordingly, and finally it reaches the destination. Now we'll talk about the challenges. Now just to tell you the challenge, it has this problem because when the buyer initiates the payment and it orders its ordering its own bank, it basically have the visibility till the payment reaches to the next level of it or the first leg of it, that is bank B. Okay, once it reaches the bank B, bank A do not have visibility how the payment is flowing in the subsequent steps. Now this gives a biggest challenge on the corporate side, because as a corporate, if I am willing to understand where my payment is currently residing, I don't have any clue about it. Now that's one of the aspects. The second part, now when the seller asked me when my payment is going to reach, I'm not sure because I'm clueless how many hops are there in between when it is going to reach. What best I can see is I've initiated the payment. Now that is the second challenge. The third part is suppose the goods requested is for $98,000. Okay, I'm not sure what all charges are getting deducted and what is the final amount it is going to receive. Now that is again one more challenge, because I cannot ask seller that did you receive this amount. Okay, now these are the challenges, you know, in the current form of, you know, payment processing. Now the SWIFT GPI has came up with the solution, and hence, you know, and we'll see, you know, how it is getting addressed here. So let's talk about the point two, that is post GPI, how does it work? Okay. So when the corporate initiates the payment, along with the payment, bank, you know, adds a tracking number to it. It is like a unique tracking reference number, which is sent across all the hops till it reaches the final destination or the beneficiary's account. Now through this tracking number, at any point of time, you know, throughout the route, one can understand where the currently payment residing at, okay, where it is stuck, you know, that kind of clarity or the visibility will be available. Now, the second point is, if you'll see, each bank is bound to, you know, transfer this payment between a specified SLA or service level agreement, or probably, for example, let's say there is a payment which is incoming to me. I have, you know, 4 hours of processing this payment. If it is outgoing payment, I have 2 hours of payment, you know, processing time. So due to this SLA, I have predefined time when it is going to reach to the corporate to or the beneficiary account. These kind of clarity or the visibility is very clearly seen. The third aspect of this SWIFT GPI is, I have clear visibility about the charges being deducted by each of the bank or the in between financial institutions. So I have a very clear picture about it. Now due to all these things, as a corporate, I have a clear visibility about it, I have clear tracking about it, I have clear charges deduction about it, and I can tell and I can assure it the prediction of the payment when it is going to reach received by the final seller or the beneficiary. Now this really adds up to the benefits which we are going to talk about. Now before we get into the details of each of the components, so SWIFT GPI has three different components attached to it. First being the tracker component, the second being the observer component, and third being the directory component. So the tracker component, of course, just to, you know, track the payments using the unique reference number. Observer being the business intelligence directory or the dashboard, which basically says that what all SLAs are defined for each of these banks, including your own bank. Okay, so it's like community banks can also be, you know, be a part of this business intelligence dashboard. And the third being the directory, it basically shows, you know, how the payment route can be achieved. So let's say there is no direct relationship, I have the correspondent bank, and there can be one more correspondent bank to reach this particular beneficiary bank. How many correspondent banks can be placed on what is the best route to reach that particular destination? What are the cutoff times for the payment of each processing banks? What are the currencies which are supported by these banks? Accordingly, I can select my best route, and finally it reaches the destination at one point of time. Please consider this, that when there is a end of the day in USA, probably it's a beginning of the day in India. When the payment transfer from one end of the continent to the other end, the timing really matters a lot, and hence the cutoff time. If I have the ability to select my route accordingly, then of course the payment will be processed quickly. GPI states that, you know, probably within 24 hours the payment will be received by the corporate once all the banks starts implementing GPI initiative.